A very good afternoon to you all. My name is Dr. Kirti. Thank you for the kind introduction, ma'am. So first of all, I would like to thank the McLean Hospital, the Harvard Medical School, and its Vahia Foundation, Nehru Science Center, my mentor, Dr. Alka Subramaniam, Ms. Arati Shroff, and a team to invite me here and giving me this platform to express my views. Well, the topic given to me is when to have the talk. A very cryptic message. Now, I would like to know from you, what is the talk about? What do you think? What is the talk about? Sorry?
Birds and bees.
Okay. So let us be more specific now. That is why we are having the talk. Yes? How many parents over here? Okay. And the rest of you are like psychology students? Yes. Okay. So first of all, before I start, a happy Valentine's Day to you all. May love prevail in whatever we do today and tomorrow. All right. So about the talk, yes. Any inputs? Yes.
Maybe when a child gets puberty, the talk between a parent and the child.
Okay. Yes. What about, yes?
The taboo topics.
And what are the taboo topics that we could be discussing with our children during the puberty time?
Physical changes as they grow up.
Yes.
Hormonal changes.
Yes.
What's safe, what's not safe.
Correct.
Permitted.
Correct.
So all of those
things. So she's given the outline of my whole talk right now. Okay.
So because I'm here to learn how to do it.
Yeah. I hope I help you in that. So yes, I'll be talking about this three-letter word, sex. More specifically, sex education. Even more specific, sexuality education. Okay? Sorry for the transitions are not working correctly, but that's fine. So let us start with a case scenario. One night at dinner, the father asked his six-year-old son what he wanted to do for work when he grew up. He replied, "I don't want to work, I just want to be a dad." Well, both the father and mother looked at each other and exchanged smiles. What happens next? Then without missing a bit, the son continued, "But I'm not sure I want to do that either, because then you have to pee in your wife." You understood? I hope the parents understood, right? That is why we are having this talk, okay? So the topic given to me is when to have a talk, but I'll take the liberty and try to include why, who, and what, and how to do this talk, okay? Okay, so what is your input? Why are we having this talk right now? Why do you need to talk to our children about sexuality?
Because there is much misleading information, like the first time a child gets to know about sex is by watching porn.
Okay.
So I personally feel like I have a sister, younger sister, so I don't want her to be introduced to sex while...
So you want to protect her from the unreliable sources, that is what you want to say. Yes, good. And? Yes. Yes, so the aim is to have a friendlier environment at home, an open environment at home, so that you be the first source that of information that they are seeking for. Correct. Anything else? Yes, correct. So just to justify why we are having this discussion, a few statistics. So the International Institute for Population Sciences have come up with this study where 13% of young men and only 26% of women had received any form of sex education. 40 to 50% of young students in India feel that they do not have adequate knowledge about sex. 65% of young people don't have adequate information to protect themselves from HIV or AIDS. And only 2 in 5 are aware that a woman could get pregnant the very first time she has sex. 35% of AIDS cases reported are below 25 years of age, 50% of the new infection between 15 to 24. That is a UNICEF study. India has the third largest HIV epidemic. 90% of the youth desire more information about sexual health, but they did not know where they could find it. That is the Hindu which has reported it. Only 10% of the youth have access to medically accurate information about sexual health. We come across these headlines very often, right? So one in every two children in India is a sexual abuse victim. Four child victims every hour, that is what the BBC reported. And 44% rise in child abuse calls to helpline in Delhi. Out of the total crime, including children, almost about 15,000 of them are registered under the POCSO Act. You know about the POCSO Act, right? And about almost 11,000 are rape cases. Few more statistics. As you can see, the graph, the bar is increasing. The number of crime against children are increasing. Premarital sex rate has increased. The average age at first for Indian women is somewhere between 15 to 19. Maybe it includes also the child marriages. Now, this is what I was just going through the news yesterday, and this is the most recent survey done by an NGO called as Vitamins 3. Very interesting name. So, survey reveals 46% of urban millennials learn about sex before 13. Who is a millennial?
A person who ages from around 18.
Correct. So, those who have attained adulthood in the first decade of this century, right? So, these are the adults, about 2,500 were surveyed. And the result is that they learn about sex before 13 years of age. And at what age do millennials become sexually active? Almost 50% of them fall in the category of 14 to 18 years. Do Indian women masturbate? Yes. About 82% agreed. 99.45% of men agreed that they masturbate. Do Indian men watch porn? Around 9 out of 10 agreed. And about 6 out of 10 agreed as far as the Indian women were concerned. So I hope that justifies why we are sitting here, right? So now, what do you mean by sexuality? We know what is sex, but what is sexuality then? Is it different? So what is the difference? Okay. Okay. What constitutes sexuality? It is a broad term, right? Okay. So when we are imparting sex education, or rather sexuality education, we need to keep this point in mind. It is not about giving information about the mechanical part of sex, rather including all these aspects, correct? So sexuality can be defined or can be explained as far as the physical, yes, that is the mechanical part, but also the psychological and the social aspects of reproduction. It also includes natural sex and the sexual development. About gender roles and gender identities. Do you know what is a gender role? Yes. Yes. Our engagement in our love relationships, role of sexuality in everyday life, and our feelings towards the person whom we are attracted to, and personal meanings that we derive from our sexual experiences. So it's a broad spectrum. So basically it is called as a sexuality wheel, and we need to keep moving it. Dimensions of the sexuality include values and beliefs apart from the body, thoughts and feelings, gender and relationships. Sexuality education, as I said, it is not just about the mechanical part, it includes all these aspects. And to explain it in a very simpler way, why it is needed right now in the teenage group or even before that, take an example of money management, right? So we have algebra. Is the child studying in fourth standard going to earn money at that point of time? No. We have accounts, right? Till the time the child grows old, he goes and has a job and he starts earning. At that time, all this knowledge is going to help him. So basically, it helps in developing a foundation for his future. Similarly, sexuality education helps in developing a foundation for a continuous learning process of knowledge, attitudes, and skills. Who is going to bell the cat? So who is going to take that responsibility? What do you think?
That's cliche.
Between
parents, elder siblings, other elders around the children.
Okay. Who are these elders around the children?
Maybe the other family members who are close to the child, maybe masis or chachas or other sisters or cousins or neighboring bhaiya.
Do you think it is safe?
Provided
Yes. 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 Okay.
Also, the government also has a responsibility.
Correct. So it's a collective responsibility. Agree. So starting with the schools and the parents. Okay. So it has to be a combined effort. Now I feel, now we all know that sex itself is a taboo in a culture, right? And hence talking about sex at home is not that comfortable. It is considered as embarrassing, a shameful act, and hence if parents start take the initiative, if they start getting involved, what it does is it ensures that your child gets authentic information. The child feels, the child has trust in their parents that okay, fine, as ma'am said, that it develops an open environment at home and a comfortable environment for the child to approach the parents. And of course it has to be age appropriate, we'll be coming to that. So once the curiosity gets satisfied, there's a less chance of seeking information from unreliable sources, as I said. Also the child gains trust and starts talking freely. Any untoward incident, the child will first come and inform you. Okay, so that is the responsibility of the parents as well as the school. It helps to promote the positive sexual health. Now at home, whether it is the father or the mother. Okay. I feel for the younger children, it has to be both. Okay. It is best if both parents talk together as it ensures stronger trust and also it lessens the stigma. Once the child hits puberty, right? It is preferable that the same sex parent first sits down and explains the changes that he is going through, and then at some point of time the second parent also gets involved later. Sometimes you have tried your best yet you find it uncomfortable. So what is the next step? Either you take help of some professional sex educators or you can approach the mental health professionals. Okay, why it is again the next step? Because it provides unbiased and age-appropriate technical information. Probably the child feels more comfortable discussing it with a person who is not a part of their daily activities, correct? And of course they don't feel judged by them. Well, sex education or sexuality education, is it the right thing to do? So there are always debates on this. We have seen so many debates on news channels. So the debates are usually from the political and the, you know, the old traditional class of our society, who argues that talking about sex or talking about sexuality will promote will encourage their sexual activity. However, it is an age-old myth. Research has shown that sex education reduces sexual activity in teens and postpones the age of first sexual act. Now we come to the bottom line. When do you start talking? What do you think? Yes. Correct.
You're teaching hand, you're teaching lips, you're teaching head, teach the body parts.
Correct. Good. So when is that?
I don't know, 1 year of age.
Correct.
Like around 3 years ago, touch back.
Right. Right.
At that time, it starts.
Okay. Anyone else? So it's a process, that is what you are emphasizing, right? It's a process.
It's a process.
Yes. Yes.
They should be worried about them at an early age. But then they should be worried about them more and more as they grow, as their exposure increases. So with time, as to whatever they encounter outside.
Yes.
As and when they should be worried about it at different times. So they know how to deal with it as and when they face.
Correct. So age appropriateness has to be taken into consideration. So to simplify this, what I chose to discuss is first we'll discuss about the sexual behavior as the age increases. So in toddlers and teens, and then we see how to talk about it. So when it is around 3 to 6 years of age, what happens physiologically and psychologically, the child becomes aware of his gender. Now they know that either they are a boy or a girl, correct? So, and that also increases their curiosity about the opposite sex. They start playing role play games, correct? Yes, I'm the husband, you're the wife. They start playing this. It's normal for children to touch their genitals, okay, at this age. Boys also have physiological erections, but non-orgasmic, okay? So these are the sexual behaviors that a child between 3 to 6 years of age will indulge in. So now, what happens is, how do you deal with such a child? So as she said, we start talking about, we name their body parts. That is what you said, right? So if we teach them what is a nose, what is a ear, why not tell them what is a penis, right? Why do we use words like, what do we use? What are the local words that we use? Nunu, right? Correct? So the correct names of the body parts and what they do are to be told. That our bodies are different. Okay, since they are aware of their gender, we need to tell them that our bodies are different and that is, it is okay to be different. Some parts of the body are private. She said about good touch and bad touch. So in that, we obviously tell them that some body parts are private and these aren't for the whole world to see. Correct? That we don't keep secrets. Ma'am talked about child abuse. So this comes into that. So we tell them that we don't keep secrets about our bodies, that they can always tell you about anything that makes them feel bad or funny. Correct? So what happens in child abuse? Usually it is the mostly it is the family relatives, some relative in the family who tries to take undue advantage of the child's innocence and tries to touch him inappropriately. So we need to tell the child what is a good touch and a bad touch. As the child grows between 6 to 9 years of age, they start forming strong peer relationships. So now they have friends, correct? And mostly they prefer the same sex friends. So boys will prefer being with boys, girls will prefer being with girls. Here is when the bullying starts, the body shaming starts. Gender preferences become stronger, okay? Gender stereotypes become stronger. Girls usually mature earlier. You might know physiologically, physically they are mature earlier than boys. And in some girls at age of 8 to 9 years probably start menstruating. Okay, so then with such children, again, now we become more specific with the body parts. We tell them what is their function. Okay, so we talk about penis, we talk about testicles, scrotum, anus, vulva, correct? That bodies come in all different shapes, sizes and colors. We need to tell them that your body might be different from the body of your friend. To be able to look after their own body, correct? You are out of your home, you are in the school for about 5 to 6 hours, you need to take care of your body. That their bodies will change as they get older. So you are priming them up for the coming puberty changes. Then comes 9 to 12 years. What happens? The curiosity about body increases. Okay. They start understanding the concept of romantic relationships. What is privacy? Okay. Any conversation with a sexual intonation, they start getting, you know, gossipy, you know, intrigued by it. And then what do they do? They start researching about it online, okay? So boys also start developing interest in girls, usually older women. So you will have boys having crush for the teachers, correct? But that, the conflict in their mind will result into what? Emotionally, they might become aggressive, or probably they'll also become hostile. Girls start taking interest in older boys and men, and in this age bracket, mostly most of the girls have started with their menstruation. So the menstruation topic has to be discussed now. So with puberty, what physical, social, and emotional changes are to be expected in puberty? The parent has to sit down and talk to the child. Girls need to note and be prepared for their first period. So the mother is the first person who needs to talk to the daughter. Boys need to know about ejaculation and wet dreams, okay? They need to be told that at some point of time, your body might feel good when touched at an appropriate or at a particular place. that sometimes people look at pictures of naked people or people having sex on the internet, and this is not for the kids. Okay, I have had many such children coming up, parents coming up and telling me that children have, we have checked our mobile history, the Google, the browser history, and we have seen certain videos, 8-year-old, 9-year-olds, okay? You also need to discuss with your child what they should do when they come across such images. So what do you expect your child to do when, you know, they come across such images? Yes? Yes. Yes. Yes.
And then if the parent finds the content is not present for the child,
yes,
then they can go to the website, they can research, they can report.
Yes, correct. And that is how you tell them how to be cyber smart and take care of themselves and how to use mobile phones safely and reasonably. Then comes the teenager group. The most volatile, you know, as far as emotions is concerned. So 12 to 15 years of age, puberty has hit most of them. All previous changes have got exaggerated. Boys start masturbating, mostly accompanied with, you know, pornography. They start demanding for privacy, spend more times in bathrooms or their own rooms, bedrooms. They start having relationships. They probably experiment with physical intimacy. They start having body image issues. Ma'am talked about body image issues, so, and we'll be talking about it later. Also, transiently, children might have homosexual fantasies, okay, which is normal. What do you do in such a, if you have a teenager as your child, what do you do? So all the previous things that we have talked, when we become more specific, we go into much detail. For daughters, we need to tell them that what is the concept of fertility, okay? That it happens once girls start having periods and you can become pregnant in such a case, okay? Boys start producing semen, that boys and girls are able to have babies after they have reached puberty. You need to talk about sexually transmitted infections. Basic information about how to avoid pregnancy. And that once puberty starts, they will slowly start to feel more sexual and develop romantic feelings towards a particular sex. That sexuality is exaggerated in pornography. It's very essential for parents to talk about this to their children, that whatever has been shown or whatever you have seen in those videos is not real. These are actors, okay? They are paid actors, correct? So everything is exaggerated. Explain that there are different sexual orientations. We start talking about orientations. Okay, so you talk about heterosexuality, homosexuality, and bisexuality. Then comes the older teenage group, that is the 15 to 18 years. Till now, the personality is almost prepared now. They are more confident about themselves. There is a highly likelihood of, you know, indulging in high risk behaviors. They tend to be very impulsive. Relationships are very common in this age, right? Pubertal changes have progressed, body image issues increase. Now they have sufficient knowledge about sex, correct? But still they might be confused, they might have conflicts which needs to be solved, resolved. So in such a case, any conflict that they have regarding sexual intercourse or about their body images needs to be tackled with. But once puberty starts, same-sex fantasies, as I've told, transient homosexuality might be present, but then that does not necessarily indicate sexual orientation. Now, the characteristic of respectful relationship, the next lecture is about relationships, right? So this will be dealt in that. How? My next question is, how do we talk? Certainly, birds and bees are not going to help in such a case, right? Simple formula is to minimize the awkwardness while talking to your child. First step is to inquire. What do we inquire? What do they know already? Okay? So you already started dialogue with them. If they have a question, you talk to them. Try to find out what knowledge do they have about that topic so that you know what is coming next, correct? then you judge. What do you judge? You judge whether that information is scientifically correct or not. If not, correct it. Right? What is next? Explain. Then comes your part. Fill the void, correct? Wherever necessary, you try to explain, as and it has to be age appropriate. It has to be simple, okay? And most of the time it has to come from the parent. Simple tips. While talking to your child about sexuality, think about how you came to know about sex at your when you were going through that. If you think it wasn't appropriate, correct it, try to, you know, be innovative, try to think about how to make it more comfortable for your child. As we already discussed, age appropriateness is very much necessary. So this means explaining things in a way that your child can understand giving their age. There is no need to answer questions they haven't asked as per their age. And don't overload them with information or else nothing will go through. So keep it simple, okay? Keep it specific. Try to keep them engaged in a dialogue whenever they ask. So what is the advantage? So when they ask questions, you also try to ask questions, as we also already discussed about inquiring. So you know about a lot many information that is coming from their side. You correct them wherever necessary. Find out what they know already and where they heard it from. So what is their source? Okay, if the source is unreliable, try to correct it then and there. This way you can correct any misinformation right from the start. Dialogue slows conversation down, giving you time to think and lets you have a better idea when to stop. Okay, it is very important to find out exactly what children are actually asking about. Be honest, children are smart, so don't lie. Okay, they can often figure out when parents are not telling them the truth. So don't beat around the bush, okay? Be very specific. If this happens, children are less likely to be receptive in the future, okay? Do not worry if you do not know the answer yourself. If you don't know the answer, accept it. Tell them. Tell them that it was a good question, but that you do not know the whole answer and that you both will sit down and find out the answer together. Again, this also helps to slow down the process and you get enough time to think about it. Read. There are various books about how to talk to your child. One of them is Sexuality Begins at Home by Dr. Armand Pandey and Dr. Nehasha. That is a very good book. There are great age-appropriate books about sex and reproduction for both parents and kids. Reading also helps get over any embarrassment. Some children might feel very shy till the time they have hit puberty. So for such kids, do not wait. Initiate a conversation with the child about sexuality. Ask them what they know and what is being taught at school. There will be situations where you might find it very embarrassing, especially in social situations where the child might have come up with a question and there are people around you. Keep your cool. Don't overreact. Okay. Get ready for the fact that sex talk will come up at badly timed moments. Do not feel you have to answer, but rather say, great question, let's talk about it in the car. Or move aside, take a private moment, talk to them, and that also helps them understand, okay, fine, these topics are not to be said in the public. It has to be shared only and only with my parents. Okay. As the child learns about sex, you can let them know that speaking about it everywhere is not appropriate. The car can be a great place, a park bench can be a great place to talk about it. As ma'am said, it's a process. It's a continuing process. So it is not that at 11 years of age, you'll sit for 2 hours with your child and you'll explain everything about sex. Okay? So it has to start very early. Children will need some things repeated in order to understand. So keep talking with your child. Simple points to remember, there is no right or wrong age to discuss about sexuality. Whenever the child has queries, it is important that it gets answered. Because if it doesn't, you know what happens next. The child might go to another person or find out another means of an unreliable source from where he might get wrong information. So again, inquire first, judge the knowledge, and then formulate the explanation. Parents often ask me, how will my child react when I talk to him or her regarding sex? Yes, there might be an anxiety, they might get surprised, there might be a bewilderment, there might be even disgust. Okay? Be prepared for it. But at the end of it, always explain them that sexuality is a normal and a natural phenomenon. Correct the misinformation, and it's your responsibility to allay their anxieties around it. Again, how do I protect my child from the wrong resources? How do you do it? We already discussed. So, what is the most commonest unreliable source where children get information? Internet. So, what do? Yes? Yes. Yes. So children need to be told that the best source of for information about sexuality will always be their parents, and they should be warned about not to rely on the internet, what friends mention, or any other stranger, for example, neighbors, the milkman, the watchman, the housekeeping staff, the older cousins, the elder friends, no, okay? And what you should avoid while talking about sexuality, what should you avoid? Age inappropriate information, yes?
Also looking, don't be much weird while talking about it.
Yes, very good. You need to be comfortable first, right?
Biasness.
Sorry?
Biasness.
Biasness. And?
You of course have questions like, do you also have it?
Yes. So how would you answer that question? It depends upon what age is the kid is, right? So too many technical terms try to avoid, okay? Too much detail that a child might not understand as per his age, avoid. If you're not comfortable, fine, you have tried your best, but there might be situations where you might not be successful. Again, as I've said, take the help of mental health professionals or any professional sex educator. A bit of pornography here. So why do children resort to pornography? What attracts them?
The feeling of being aroused.
Yes. Yes. Curiosity.
Their friends are maybe seeing it.
Peer pressure. And? So what happens in pornography? At some point of time, every one of us have persisted. So what happens in pornography? First, of course, easy accessibility because of the internet, because of the mobile phones. Attraction to the sexual imagery, idealistic portrayal of the sexual act, correct? Ultimately, psychologically, it gets converted to addiction. So is it normal for my teen to watch porn? Is it normal?
No, I would not actually give a specific permission to watch porn.
Yes.
If I come across, if a man, my boy is watching porn, I will not make a big issue.
Good. So watching pornography in this age can be considered as a normal developmental process, a part of it, but once it starts getting converted to addiction, we need to intervene. Once it starts becoming compulsive enough that it starts interfering its the academics, we need to intervene. Addiction happens when there is a dire need to watch porn, and it is usually accompanied with masturbation also. So there you require psychological intervention. So what does the parent do? The parent has to keep an eye on what the children are viewing online. Do not overreact, as ma'am said, if you catch your child watching porn. Yes. Sit down, be calm, speak to the child. Internet safety settings, there are various softwares. Check what kind of sites the child was visiting and how did he land up to those sites. Okay. Explain to them what are the limits of viewing porn and what are the cons of continuing to watch it again. Ma'am has already covered a bit of child abuse in the previous lecture, but just something related to it. What is child abuse? What is child abuse? Sorry? Sexual, physical,
emotional.
Yes, one word is missing, just one word. That is what it makes it comprehensive, and that is neglect. Okay. So yes, the physical, the psychological, the emotional, all abuses are included, the mistreatment is included, and also neglect is considered as a child abuse. So actions that cause mental anguish or physical and sexual hurt comes under child abuse. Touching and non-touching activities. What are the non-touching activities that can be considered as child abuse? Talking about sexuality education. So this has to be included in your talk. You have to explain that there might be someone who might show you inappropriate images. You need to report it to me. Okay? Few statistics again. 1 out of every 2 children in India is sexually abused, 52% of them being boys. Maharashtra, the forerunner of it. So how do you, what are the warning signs of child abuse? Sudden change in a child's behavior. So you need to notice that while having the talk. Nightmares, sleeping issues, bedwetting. The child becomes unusually secretive, okay, withdrawn. Very clingy at times. Academics have taken a hit. There are sudden mood swings, anger, aggression. There's insecurity around. The child starts stammering. Okay. There might be a incidents of self-harming behavior. And then physical bruises, of course. Pain around genitals, avoidance of a particular person or situation. And sometimes the child resorts to an adult-like sexual behavior. So these are the warning signs of child abuse you need to keep in mind. So what can I do to keep my child safe? Always know where and with whom your child is as much as possible. Always keep a check. Communicate. That's the bottom line of every lecture that you will be having today. Communicate with your child on a regular basis. Discuss issues related to safety in such situations, and good touch and bad touch seminars can be taken for them. Concept of personal boundaries, consent, okay? What are the safety boundaries? What is the safety behavior? Look out for verbal and non-verbal distress signals, and do not ignore any such sign, okay? What's the conclusion? So in my opinion, the whole idea of sexuality education is this: to impart or to inculcate in the mind of these youths that sex is a natural, normal, and a pleasurable act in a mutually respectful and loving relationship, okay? Sex education needs to be a bit active. Appropriate and timely guidance about various aspects of sexuality need to be taken. What does it result into? The child knowing their rights. The child recognizing the problems, and the child seeking help whenever needed. They have a balanced perspective towards gender roles. They are mindful about, they're self-aware about everything. They develop healthy emotions about sexual intimacy and act in a responsible manner if the sexuality education starts right in the beginning. The skills that a teenager needs to develop in order to manage their sexual feelings healthfully takes time. So starting early will always help. What are the life skills that need to be taken into consideration while talking to a child? Decision making. You might be teaching your students, right, in schools. Decision making, critical thinking, self-awareness, and communication skills. So as we help our kids make sense of sexual behavior, we will want to focus on teaching them strategies for making healthy sexual decisions. Okay? Along with teaching them refusal and negotiation skills so they know how to manage peer pressure. Teaching our kids how to make responsible sexual decisions and learning the importance of the big three. What are the big three? That is, love, respect, and trust has to be there in the relationship, okay, prior to having any sexual intercourse. Finally, it is never too early to start, but it is always possible that it could be too late. Okay. Never avoid a teachable moment. Never miss it. Never ignore. Okay, every time the child comes with a query, answer it then and there. So the talk should be a series of small conversations spread over many years, not at a single setting. You as the parent should aim to become the obvious go-to person whenever there's a question. Give them that confidence. So with that, I end the lecture, and a bit about my project in Virar. This is SMILE, it is School Mental Health and Integrative Learning and Education. I've incorporated it in three schools right now. So I usually take child workshops for students. For teacher, I take some trainings, and for parents, I take some seminars as well. This is just, so I was taking a lecture on adolescent mental health. That's my wife on the right. So she is a gynecologist, so she's taking on menstrual health. That's my psychologist on bullying and body shaming and how to seek help. And those are the children having a group session. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nandu. We'll be able to take three questions.
When is the right time to talk to a boy about menstruation?
As I've already said in one slide, whenever the boy comes to you at that point of time.
What if he doesn't come?
So I always, as in those menstrual health, whenever what happens is, during our times, whenever there was a menstruation class for the girls, what used to happen, the boys used to go out and play football, cricket, whatever it used to happen. I never do that. Whenever my wife takes a class for menstruation for the girls, I usually have a separate class for boys where I also talk about menstruation to them. Boys need to know about menstruation because it inculcates good values in them because they are going to be husbands in future. They need to have that responsibility towards their companion. Okay, so if you are asking about a right age, whenever the puberty hits, that is the right time to talk about them. Okay, because the body is changing. There are changes in emotions. They are receptive towards it at that point of time. So it is always better to give that information then and there. Yes.
Or whether you want to tell that it is quite natural to do that.
As I've said, those three words, inquire, find out where is this information coming from, where either is it, as you said, okay, fine, coming out from pornography videos. Also, this might be discussed between them, between the peers, peer groups as well, okay? Now, we need to know what is the child's perspective about it first, before correcting it, okay? So, it is always better to give them the pros and cons about that situation. And again, age appropriateness has to be taken into consideration. Give them the chance to decide about it first. Okay, and if you find, as a parent, if you think that the decision that they are taking or the perspective that they are developing about it is somewhat not normal, you need to take a step and correct it over there.
And mostly the sons get these images from mobiles of their fathers most of the times. So what about this double standard?
So again, accessibility has to be taken into consideration again here. If they are the mobile, the father's mobile is accessible to the child, the father also has to be a bit responsible about it. Okay, so now the family has to work as a unit over here and need to talk about it and discuss about it, set certain guidelines about it, and then keep the child away from it. I won't say it is healthy, unless, when does a child resort to pornography? It is the curiosity, correct? In one of the slides I've already written, if the curiosity is addressed at an earlier age, probably the child may not resort to such situations. So I wouldn't call it as a normal, I would not try to normalize it, but yes, it is a part of the developing process. The child, you usually find teens, whenever they hit puberty, they resort to, you know, finding out about these videos when they don't have a reliable source of information. So I won't say it is normal.
So for the father who probably has it on his phone, you know, would you rather address that? I mean, you're going to reproduce or would you say that take away the phone from the son? I mean, adults, because I want to know.
See, pornography, whether it is right or wrong, is itself a controversial statement.
Exactly.
To
so I just want to know, you as a medical person, you know, is it something only a moral question, or is
pornography
is it also
as an addiction is a problem?
Okay.
So when you resort to pornography and there is a dire need to watch it, there is a compulsive behavior in it, then yes, you need to intervene in it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tandel.